Hello! Well, it's been a little while since I've made a video, and I'm not totally sure I can remember how to do this. In the meanwhile, I've noticed that quite a few channels, they've all got music at the start of their videos, so I'm going to do that too. And so here we go. Da-da-da-da-da, it's a video. Da-da-da-da-da, let's start the video. How's that? I think, well, I'll see what kind of response we get from that. Right, our video today is on protein synthesis, looking at, protein synthesis, and that is subdivided into transcription and translation, and I still haven't really learned to use a pen properly. There we go. And we're going to do two videos, the first broadly covering transcription, the second covering translation. So let's kick off with transcription. We start by thinking about what DNA actually is. DNA is that famous molecule that we store in our nuclei. And of course, each of our nuclei contain all of our genes. So each one and every one of our cells that have a nucleus can make anything you want them to make. You'll see here, this is this classical structure of DNA. And you'll remember from your studies, of course, that DNA is a double helix with paired bases in the middle of that double helix. Adenine pairing with thymine, guanine pairing with cytosine. Key here is therefore we have a sequence of bases. If you look here, we go, if we were reading it in this direction, we'd read adenine, thymine, guanine, thymine, I think there's a guanine there, and then a thymine, and then et cetera, et cetera. So you've got an alphabet of four letters, but a word that is very, very long. The word itself, or sentence, or phrase, or is as long as that DNA molecule itself. Looking on this side over here, this is what you would see if you were looking down from a top. You're looking down here, this is what you would see. You'd see thymine here, paired up with adenine, with hydrogen bonds holding them together. Then you've got the sugar and the phosphate, and these are what are going to give us our backbone. This represented in blue here, that's the sugar phosphate backbone. So what is DNA for? As we've said, DNA carries a sequence of letters, and that is the all-important information. Those letters, there are only four of those letters, so it's an alphabet of four. But that alphabet of four codes for an alphabet of 20, an alphabet of 20 amino acids. Amino acids are the building blocks of proteins. If you put amino acids together in a particular sequence, then this chain of amino acids will, with some cellular help, fold up, first of all, to form structures like these, and then ultimately to form this here, which is called a tertiary structure. Now, this is a three-dimensional structure. This three-dimensional structure then itself has a function. This protein with the 3D structure has a function. And many proteins, I haven't shown it here, they are actually made out of several of these three-dimensional structures put together. Sometimes we would just refer to this structure here as a polypeptide chain. But for our purposes now, we're going to call it a protein and consider it to be a finished protein. For this point here, I want you to see that the sequence of the letters here give us the sequence of amino acids on the polypeptide chain here. How does it do that? That is what we're going to do over these next two videos. Before we continue, we need to meet another nucleic acid, and that is RNA. RNA is a close sister molecule of DNA. It's very, very similar, you can see here, but you can see the big obvious difference immediately, which is that RNA is single-stranded, whereas DNA is double-stranded. RNA also carries just very slightly different bases. The C, the G, and the A, of course, are the same as the C, the G, and the A of DNA, but instead of DNA's thymine, RNA has uracil. The base pairings are the same for RNA and as for DNA. C pairs with G. A pairs with Well, because U is the substitute for T, A pairs with U. RNA is typically much shorter than DNA. It tends to be a copy, a single-stranded copy of a short bit of DNA. Let's just look at this over here. Let's say we've got DNA. Here is our DNA, all squiggly drawn like this. Blah, 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 blah. And it's double-stranded like this, and therefore, and it carries on, therefore. There we go. And it, you know, it'll carry on in this direction, and it'll carry on in this direction. If we were making RNA, we might take a section between here and here, and just make a copy of one of these strands. And so we'll get that, but its bases will be complementary to those of the strand of which it is a copy. I'll show you that now. This is DNA to RNA, and our word here is transcription. Transcription means script, well, that's writing, and trans means across. So we're writing across. We're writing in the same language pretty much, but we're writing across from DNA to RNA. This is our DNA here. We've got a double helix, and you can see our enzyme here, RNA polymerase. RNA polymerase moves along in this direction, as shown by the arrow, and it unwinds the DNA, and that exposes the bases of the DNA in this region. These exposed bases aren't particularly happy by themselves. And so we have RNA nucleotides here, that is a nucleotide triphosphate, which is what NTP stands for, like ATP. ATP would be an RNA nucleotide. These chaps or chapesses come in here and they'll bind on like so. And so if we've got an A here on the DNA, well, we'll get a U coming on here with the rest of the molecule, its sugar and its phosphate. And if we've got a G here on the DNA, then we're going to get a C coming in here, a CTP coming in here. It'll lose two of its phosphates and will continue to make this chain of RNA. So our RNA grows as the RNA polymerase moves this way along the molecule. And then when it's done, it just is very kind, it doesn't leave a mess behind it, and it kind of allows the DNA to recoil back up in these nice coils. So at the end of this, we have the DNA rewound around itself, and we have a nice molecule of RNA coming off it. Then what do we do with that RNA? I want you to think of the DNA being a little bit like a hard drive of a computer. Let's say you've got a homework assignment, you've got to write an essay. Yay! Oh, I know we all love writing long essays. You've done your essay, you've worked hard on it, and you've saved it on your hard drive. Now you've got to go into school and get it printed out. What are you going to do? Well, of course, what you're going to do is you're going to take your hard drive out of your computer, and you're not going to do that. There's no way you'd do that. Your hard drive stays where it is. That information on the hard drive stays where it is. What you would do instead, of course, is you'd get a flash drive, you'd copy the information on here, so you got your file here on your hard drive, you'd make a copy of it, that copy would stay there, but then you'd save a copy of that information on your flash drive, and you'd take that flash drive into school to print out because your printer's broken at home or whatever it is. The equivalent to that is here. Our DNA, well, our nucleus is like our hard drive. Our nucleus is like the hard drive because it stores all the information, and we have the information, let's say your essay plus all the other stuff you've got stored on your hard drive. You make a copy only of the bit that you need, and that copy is your mRNA. Your mRNA is like your flash drive, which you then take out of the nucleus and you can use somewhere else, like in school, to print off your essay or whatever you want to do with it. And so transcription makes a copy of a short stretch of DNA in the form of RNA. That RNA is then able to leave the nucleus, if it's a eukaryotic cell, and be used elsewhere in the cell. Well, that process is transcription. Our next process is translation, and that's what we'll look at in the next video. Thank you.